today what I want to talk about are two topics, really. The first one is a perspective on men's health. And before you ladies get all self-defensive about it, it really is more than men's health, and you'll understand in a minute. And then the second part of the lecture will be on testosterone itself. So first of all, this is not a new slide, it's not a new issue. We all know that men around the world diet on average at an earlier age than women do. Remember, it's an average, so there's a lot of men who live long, healthy lives, and a lot of women who die prematurely. But on average, men die about 4 to 6 years sooner than women do. I always get the joke, why do Jewish men die before their wives?
Because they want to.
That's cute. Canadian men are living in poor health for up to 9 years. So we talk about life expectancy. That's that slide I just showed you on average age that people die. But health expectancy is how long are you living towards the end of your life in good health or bad health? And on average, men are in bad health for about 9 years before they die. And unhealthy men make for unhealthy families and unhealthy communities. We did a survey a couple of years ago that shows in an age group of 30 to 54, which is really in our men's health initiatives, are our primary goal. That's our target. We want to get these guys to change their behaviors in some way. 58% do not see diet as healthy. So over half of them are not eating healthy. And you heard from Saul how important diet is. 43% are not exercising. 44% are not sleeping enough. These are three critical factors or parameters that lead to chronic illness. So over half of men in this country are not healthy. Now half are, or close to half are. That's not our target. And those who are doing well and are exercising and eating healthy, God bless them, let them continue to do that. Our target are the other half. The good news is that over 70% of chronic illness can be prevented. Now, a number of years ago, the NIH, National Institute of Health, had a 3P target. They had 3 Ps, precision, prevention, and preemption. So we have to be precise when we look at our individual targets, at our patients, at the population. We have to think about prevention, and Saul touched on that, and I will as well, and be preemptive. We also did a health economic analysis. So it's more than just the individual being ill. When you look at it from a community or societal point of view, it's costing us a lot of money. $37 billion per year. And that's just for men's chronic illness in this country. So imagine if we can cut that down by 10% or 20% or 50%, how good that will be for our economy. And then Justin Trudeau will have more money to spend. And the cost to the family is enormous as well. We did this interesting study that looked at, there was a lot of moans and groans there when I mentioned Justin's name. I'm going to mention his name again soon. I guess it's not a good idea to be political in an audience like this. Okay, unhealthy behaviors are costing you money. So when you take it down to the individual, if you look at out-of-pocket expenses plus the insurance premiums, that if you drink 5 drinks a day, 5 cigarettes a day, or 40 cigarettes per day, or 70 extra pounds versus 150 extra pounds, if you do the math, the amount of money that you would save if you didn't buy those cigarettes, if you didn't drink that booze, and if you lost weight, and the insurance companies didn't charge you so much for your premiums, would range from $1.7 million to $8.6 million lifetime. So one of the programs that we had last year during Men's Health Week was anybody could be a millionaire. And with that money, you can go to Las Vegas. So in our society, when we talk about men's health and chronic illness, it's not just guys dying. It's guys disappearing. Men are disappearing because of chronic mental illness, depression. They're abandoning their families. They're abandoning their employers. And our society just doesn't see men's health as a problem. And historically, men's health, we stick our heads in the sand. We just assume men are men, and we live with it. But the reality is that men's health is really family's health. We have women's health. There have been some great programs and a lot of good work going on, and I hope that it continues for many years. We have great programs for children's health. We've addressed minority health for many, many years, but what's been missing from this puzzle of family health has been men's health. We've been trying to understand what is it that make men die sooner on average than women do. It's a real puzzle, but our studies have shown that the big three are cardiovascular disease. Not that women don't die of heart attacks, but when a man at age 40 has an MI or an event, as Saul refers to it, or stroke or whatever, they tend to die. They do a good job of it. Women, fortunately, do survive a little bit longer and die at a later age. Suicide and motor vehicle accidents or reckless behavior are the big three. A lot of people just think it's men and masculinity. And, you know, I like this. You know, this is really the man's brain. That's the toilet aiming cell. Women will appreciate that. Lame excuses gland. Dangerous pursuits. These are all true. But there really are a lot of other factors involved. There are biological factors. Men and women, our brains are hardwired differently. We have different hormones that impact on our behavior in different ways. Different physical differences so that men will take riskier jobs. You don't see a lot of female bloggers because it requires a certain physique and strength. So men take, just by nature, will be taking the riskier jobs. Men seek less social support, which is very important in survivorship. There are behavior factors. Men like to take higher risks. They avoid healthcare. They are not big on prevention. And the old traditional masculine role that goes into our primitive brains for eons, we have been the hunters and the gatherers, women and children first into the lifeboat and so on. This year, thousands of men will die from stubbornness. No, we won't. So, how do we engage guys? So this is all true. I mean, we know how men behave. We know that there are differences between men and women in all of those areas I showed you. And when I started this a number of years ago, I felt like I was banging my head against the wall, trying to get guys to change. How do you get guys, particularly a 30-year-old man, how do you get them to change? So how do we engage with men so that they'll be talk about their health and they'll understand it? And that's where Green Eggs and Ham comes in. And many of you are familiar with Dr. Seuss and his Green Eggs and Ham. So I could not, would not, on a boat, I will not with a goat, I will not, and so on and so on. That's men. We will not, we cannot, we don't want to, we don't like them anywhere. Sam, if you will let me be, I will try them, you will see. I do so like green eggs and ham. Thank you, Sam, I am. Okay, so we have to get guys to engage. We have to get them to think, I can do this. I can talk about my health. I can address my health issues. And when you talk about men's health, we're not just talking about urologic issues, the things that I deal with in my practice on a day-to-day basis, prostate cancer, enlarged prostates, other pathologies that relate to the male genitals and the male body. Okay. I like to say that the male health or men's health is more than a penis and a prostate. And overall, you can see the number of areas that need to be addressed in men's health. So even though I'm a urologist founding these men's health initiatives, this goes well beyond my expertise in my area of specialty. And it was a number of years ago when Justin Trudeau was a member of parliament. This was during the Movember, and unfortunately we can't play the video, but he read in the Hansard in the House of Commons in Ottawa that Dr. Goldenberg states that men are more than a penis and a prostate. So that quote of mine will forever be in the Hansard of the House of Commons in Ottawa. That's my epitaph. So we founded the Canadian Men's Health Foundation. This is an NGO, it's a national organization, nonprofit, that is trying to create a social movement. We want to make Canadian men the healthiest in the world. We feel that men's health should be a habit. It's a social movement. It's no different than helmets when you're riding a bike, recycling, seatbelts. Okay, when we started, when I was growing up, we had seatbelts, but nobody used them. Now you won't. Your grandchildren won't let you start the car if you don't do up your seatbelt. So it's become instinctive, it's become accepted, and expected. And that's where we're aiming to go with men's health. So we want to get men connected. We want to connect them in a way that allows them. So men need permission, particularly young guys. And I'm sure many of you have sons and maybe grandsons in their 30s and 40s. These guys need permission to pay attention to their health. So we need to talk to them, and we need to give them that space, that freedom and encouragement, so that they can understand how they can change their behaviors. We have to get their attention, we have to get them thinking, we have to get them talking, we have to get them knowing, and then get them acting. So this is not an easy task, and it's not an overnight deal. It's not like just giving somebody a pill. So there's a lot of effort involved here, a lot of people, we've got a great team. One of the things that we've done is thought about, guys are different. Not every man gets the message, it will hear a message the same way. So if the message is Saul's message, eat more fruits and vegetables, less fat in your diet and exercise more, one guy might hear it, another guy will not, it'll just go over his head. And if you think about participation and a lot of the other programs that have been around for years, a very small number of people actually got involved. And I believe it's because of communication. Not everybody listens the same way. In medicine, we're talking about precision medicine, being precise, looking at the genetics of a disease or of an individual, and applying the appropriate drug to that individual based on precision. We're talking about precision in communication as well. You have to know your customers. This is not new. It's been in the retail world and the schmata business for years. If Hulk Renfrew wants to sell a blouse to a certain demographic of women, they're going to adjust their advertising so that that demographic is going to listen to them or is going to hear them. Okay? They don't care if I look at it. I'm not their target. So communication has to be targeted. I'm not going to go into this research but in great detail, but suffice to say that you can separate men out into different morphologies of how they listen. So you can have the denial of vulnerability guy, the youth and power. All he's interested in is his abdominal musculature, the six-pack, and having sex six times a day. That guy is going to listen to a message very differently than the delegation. The fellow who will listen if his wife talks to him. Or the suppression, which many of us are, where we're too busy. We're 30 years old, 35 years old, we have new families, we have jobs. Our health will just deprioritize it. Let's put it over here, we'll put it on the shelf for now. Unfortunately, too many of us do that. So our approach at the Canadian Men's Health Foundation is to create a social movement and to combine medical and social initiatives. These are just some of the programs that we're doing. This is a national foundation out of Vancouver. You check, don't change much, and so on. And I'll go over just a couple of these. I'm not going to go over all of them. Our Don't Change Much campaign was based on focus groups across the country, where young men in this target zone would say, we don't want to change, wholesale change. I don't want to change everything in my life. So we're saying, you don't have to change everything. Do small things, okay, small changes. Half fries, half salad. Three beers instead of four. Walk an extra block. Park your car a little bit further away. Get off the bus a little sooner. Just little things that will eventually become habits, and habits become behavioral changes or permanent behavioral changes. Again, we had a TV commercial, which I can't show you, that went national and won all kinds of awards. Getting men to don't change much. We have websites. And I would encourage you to tell the young men in your families to go to don'tchangemuch.ca. On that website there's Trudeau again. He's not my favorite politician, he just happens to be the Prime Minister. And he was very supportive. The federal government gave us $5 million to go national, and he appeared in a TV commercial for us during Men's Health Week. The Canadian hockey teams have been very supportive. Hockey is Canada's pastime, and this group of men will listen to athletes, to hockey players, a lot better than they're going to listen to me. So we have these champions. In Toronto, Brendan Shanahan. Here, Trevor Linden, Cassie Campbell. These are all great hockey players. Shea Emery was a a football player, Adam Creek, a gold medalist, Luc Robitaille in Quebec, he's a Hockey Hall of Famer, Alain Vigneault, head coach of the Rangers. Jim Houston is absolutely fantastic with us, Simon Whitfield, and so on. So you can see these are the champions that we're using to help us get our messages across Canada. U-Check is a very individual tool. In 5 minutes, you can know what your risks are of heart disease, depression, type 2 diabetes, prostate cancer, testosterone, erectile dysfunction, osteoporosis, and we'll expand these. If you ask the guy to go online and to look at his, to try to determine what his risks are for each one of these one at a time, he'll quit after one or two. So the idea of the U-Check tool was to get everything at once. You have to answer a series of 30 questions and the computer algorithm will spit out your risks for all of those things. Our metrics are good, we've been very successful. I'm not going to go through all of that, except for this one. 72% of the participants in our program are now reporting healthier behavior. So we are having an impact. It's early, but we have a long ways to go. But that was a show and tell to let you know that the Canadian Men's Health Foundation, out of our group here in Vancouver, has now gone national, and I think over the coming decade is going to have a huge impact on men and families in this country. So let me just talk about testosterone for a couple of minutes. I have about 10 minutes left. So menopause, it's a big deal. It's a $2 billion industry in North America, giving men testosterone. So what is testosterone? Testosterone is the most powerful and possibly the most misunderstood hormone in human biology. It colors the fabric of the male persona, makes him a breeder and a battler, a womanizer and a warrior, a lover and a conqueror. It was first isolated in 1935, so we've had it available for many, many years. In fact, the first trial of giving a man testosterone was in 1944. Aging has a significant impact. I'll talk about this again in a moment, but after age 30, our serum testosterone levels drop by about 1.5% per year. So is testosterone the root of all evils in aging males? Is it making men cranky? Is it making them die of heart disease? Is it making them develop prostate cancer and so on? Well, in the early years, testosterone is critically important to form our masculinity, physical and psychological. This is Saul Israel in the early years. He really hasn't changed much. Testosterone levels impact on libido. That reads, if you can't see to the back, it's the woman is saying to the man, I know you want to look, don't turn your head, you're a dead man if you look. And he's thinking, somebody kill me. Testosterone is very important for normal erectile function. It's very important for cognitive function. It's critically important for normal mood and emotive activity. So low testosterone can lead to depression. It leads to male aggression. I assure you that these drivers are not women. It impacts on bone. We talk about osteoporosis in men being not that common. In fact, 1 in 8 men will develop osteoporosis compared to 1 in 4 women. So even though it's less common in men, it still is an illness of men as their testosterone gets lower in aging. It's important for muscle development. So if you have low testosterone, you get a change in your strength. And on fat distribution. The search continues. It's a coronary function for your heart function, for your blood cells, insulin, metabolic syndrome. So testosterone is a critically important hormone. And as I mentioned up front, not that well understood. But what we do know is that there's a huge market out there, and the market is growing. You can see back in 2000 what the prescription rate was compared to 2014. Newer agents are coming out, different gels, different injectables. And the drivers behind this, people say, are aging populations, a link of low testosterone with poor general health, a reduced concern of testosterone prostate cancer, new entries of drugs with a lot of marketing, and if you go to the States, there's a lot of direct-to-consumer marketing for testosterone. And we even see that in Canada. So testosterone is causing some high drama in our world of medicine. There's a lot of controversy. And as I mentioned, there are drivers, okay? Anti-aging. Will taking testosterone really preserve your youth? Will taking testosterone improve your erections? So that's for you. Physical appearance. Will testosterone help you look like a stud with a six-pack? Okay, when we're young, testosterone is critically important. It may lose its effect after marriage. You can't see the titles from back there, but basically these are just headlines about men taking testosterone. There's pushes, in marketing, and it's dividing the medical field. Are there risks? Are there not risks? It's a very challenging area right now. We call the low testosterone deficiency syndrome today. It used to be called andropause. It was even called penopause at one time. It's also known today as hypogonadism or late onset hypogonadism. The gonads are in your testicles, so if they're not producing enough testosterone, you have a deficiency. And as I mentioned, it does decrease with age. 25% of men age 40 to 82 are testosterone deficient. So there's a lot of low testosterone out there. What we don't know is what testosterone level any given individual should have. So there are guys who have high testosterone levels, and there are guys who don't have such high testosterone levels. I don't know what my testosterone was at age 30. I don't know what Saul's testosterone was at age 30. But now I'm over 60, he's approaching 60. And what should our levels of testosterone be? Should they be the same as they were at 30? If I was a high testosterone at age 30 and he was a low testosterone, probably at age 30. And today we both have a testosterone of 8. I won't explain the numbers, but say 8. Well, for me, if I started at 25, 8 is pretty low. If he started at 10, 8 isn't much lower. Okay? So we don't know that. So in any given individual, we can't just base our diagnosis on what the testosterone level is. We have to look at the whole picture, the syndrome. Okay? What are the symptoms? So if a man is symptomatic, if he has a loss of erections, but more importantly, a loss of libido, if he has difficulty attaining an orgasm, his energy level is low, his sense of well-being is off, he's tired, he's falling asleep over dinner, he's in a depressed mood, he's not thinking well, his bone mineral density is low, his muscle mass is low, his strength is low, he has more body fat, developing breasts, what we call gynecomastia, he's anemic, insulin resistant. These are all manifestations of low testosterone. They tend to be either present alone. You may only have a diminished libido if your testosterone is just sort of beginning to drop, but if your testosterone is really low, you're going to have many of these manifestations. I mentioned already how it drops with aging, so the older you are, the lower your testosterone is going to be. And very importantly, two diseases, diabetes and metabolic syndrome, which also includes, in addition to diabetes, high blood pressure and high lipids, are associated with low testosterone. And it works both ways. So a large number of diabetics will have a low testosterone. A lot of diabetics will have poor erections because of vascular disease related to diabetes and also because of low testosterone. So if you have diabetes, particularly if you're a diabetic male and you have erectile dysfunction and you're 55 years old, get your testosterone checked. What about death? Can low testosterone increase your risk of, what do you call it, Hebra Kadisha, right? So deaths, this was a study out of Seattle, go back here, 858 veterans were studied. Their testosterone was measured over a period of 5 years, and a certain number of them had a low testosterone, some of them had a borderline level of testosterone, and some of them had normal testosterone. And if you looked at it, those with normal deaths occurred 20%, 25% in those with low, with equivocal, and 35% in those with very low testosterone. So there may be a link between low testosterone and mortality. The green line shows the guys who have low testosterone, and this is survivorship here. So over a period of 8 to 10 years, more men with low testosterone are dying than those men with normal testosterone. So a lot of people will say, well, if a man is found to have low testosterone, you could increase his chances of living longer by giving him more. Now Saul talked about the Hefer Kedisha, and testosterone replacement and the risk of cardiovascular disease is a very hot topic right now, because there are a lot of studies out there that suggest that there is, that testosterone is good for your cholesterol, it's good for your blood pressure, it's good for your coronary arteries. But there have been other studies, and epidemiologically they're confusing, that are suggesting that maybe giving testosterone to a man is dangerous and may lead to increased cardiovascular events. So we know that low testosterone levels have been associated with increased cardiovascular disease and mortality. So we know that low testosterone is not good. The effects are variable. There's a world of literature out there one day it's good for you, the next day it's not good for you. So good data is missing. What about prostate cancer and prostate health? Is testosterone replacement therapy dangerous? This has been a question not in the last decade, but for many, many decades. And the research has never shown evidence that testosterone can cause prostate cancer in men, that men with high testosterone levels are at greater risk of prostate cancer than a man with low testosterone levels, or that treating men who have low testosterone increases the risk of them developing prostate cancer. Never. No evidence whatsoever. There's no data that supports the idea that prostate cancer rate is increased with testosterone replacement therapy. In fact, normal testosterone may be protective. Men with low testosterone levels may actually get worse types of prostate cancer. Yes, there are anecdotal cases of cancer when you give a man testosterone and they come back with a cancer, but those tend to be associations and not causation. There's no proof that actually bringing that man's testosterone back to normal caused the cancer. So with prostate cancer, we're still in that same space, that same paradigm, that early detection is important, and we have to understand the disease that we uncover in a given individual. So what do you do if you have low testosterone and a history of prostate cancer? My suggestion is that if you're symptomatic, if you have a manifestation of low testosterone that will be corrected by giving testosterone, take testosterone and monitor your prostate very carefully. The blood test, the PSA blood test, rectal exam if you still have your prostate in place, haven't had it removed, and just be cautious. But why do we want to penalize a guy whose testosterone is low because he has a history of prostate cancer when his next door neighbor has the exact same prostate cancer but a normal testosterone? And one guy is schlepping around with his tophus on the ground because he has no energy. Give him testosterone and watch the cancer. To me, that makes sense. The purists out there will say, no. It's like putting him now. Yeah, Photoshop, it's amazing. Okay, last point. The simplest way to increase your testosterone is to follow Dr. Isserow's advice. Diet and exercise. Lose weight. Okay, that is the best way to increase your testosterone. At the same time, it's going to improve a whole lot of other things. Your mental health, your cognition, it'll decrease your risk of cardiovascular disease, as you heard, diabetes, colon cancer, chronic lung disease, and so on. So men's health is the final piece of the puzzle of family health. Let's remember that women are critically important in this. That says, with this, I'm going to control your life. Women, you have to help your sons, your brothers, your husbands, your fathers. We have to get them to pay attention to their health. We have our men's health, our Our Men's Health Week coming up June 12th to 18th leads up to Father's Day. You'll be seeing a lot in the media about men's health. So let's all think about our men. Let's think about improving their health, communication with our men, and getting them to pay attention to prevention so that when they're older, the chronic diseases will not be a problem. Thanks very much.